February 18th, 2017. At the Cloudflare HQ, work began winding down this Friday afternoon as the weekend approached. Morale was high, and no one was prepared for the disaster that was about to happen. The engineers were excited to go home early and enjoy the beautiful weekend free of any operational issues. Suddenly, 4:11 p.m. Pacific time, at the friendly neighborhood Google complex, one of the Googlers working in Project Zero, a security research team, discovered a severe issue with Cloudflare's system. He immediately reached out through the most sensible channel for something urgent like this, and first contact was made minutes later. It was now 4:32 p.m., and the alarming details of the report were made clear to Cloudflare, suggesting a possible widespread data leak.
It's always a Friday afternoon. I've written my weekend.
You may have seen Cloudflare's DDoS mitigation service before. This is built on top of their primary product, a content delivery network, or CDN. CDNs came into existence in the 1990s to speed up the delivery of internet content. They're kind of like distribution centers. Amazon isn't just going to have a single warehouse in the middle of the United States that every delivery driver starts from. There are many spread all across the country, and they store, or should I say cache, commonly sold items to minimize delivery time. Similarly, it makes no sense to deliver internet content to all users across the world from a single centralized source. A CDN will have many points of presence across the world, with edge servers that cache content from the origin server. When a user makes a request for a particular website, the request is directed to the nearest edge server, where the content is most likely already cached. It was here that Cloudflare not only returned the requested website, but also cookies, keys, and other sensitive customer data. This is what it would look like. If you knew where to look, plenty of useful information could be extracted from the leaked memory. Full HTTPS requests, IP addresses, responses, passwords, and who knows how long this exploit has been out there. Bad actors could have already compromised thousands of companies. And Cloudflare's monitoring evidently did not self-detect this issue, as a third party had to identify it and reach out to them. Data leakage like this can come with hefty consequences. FTC fines, lawsuits, increased audits, but most importantly of all, it degrades customer trust. No customer trust, no customers. No customers, no revenue. No revenue, no Taco Tuesdays. To make matters worse, search engines like Google also regularly index and cache websites, so this leaked data could also be accessed through Google's cache. 4:40 p.m. Now this was serious business. Everyone immediately assembled in San Francisco. Maybe even some cross-company action with the Google employees. The engineers noticed in the dashboards that the occurrence of this bug seemed to correlate with the usage of the email obfuscation feature, which was also immediately suspected as it had a recent deployment to partially migrate to a new HTML parser. Either way, every feature that Cloudflare ships comes with a feature flag, and engineers immediately flipped what they called the global kill, which would prevent all customers from using the feature. By 5:22 PST, about an hour after the initial report, email obfuscation had been disabled worldwide. However, the bug was still occurring. On the other side of the Atlantic, the London team had joined the call. All hands on deck, it was time to spend the Friday night debugging and rethinking life. 8:24 PM PST, 4 hours in. Another two features were found to be problematic. Automatic HTTP rewrites and server-side excludes. Automatic HTTP rewrites was shut down immediately with its global kill. But server-side excludes was such an old feature that it predated the practice of deploying with global kills. The engineers had a crossroads here. They could release a patch for this feature to allow it to be turned off, but that would take some time for implementation and deployment. Alternatively, they could spend time root causing the issue and deploy a single proper fix, but the root cause was not apparent. Thus, the engineers began working on the global kill for server-side excludes and readied it for deployment. 11:22 PM PST, 7 hours in. As the night progressed, streets outside the San Francisco office grew quieter. Daybreak in London, the engineers were more than ready to sign off and get some much-needed sleep. The patch to turn off server-side excludes was finally deployed worldwide, but there was still much work to be done. Cache data from search engines still needed to be purged, and without knowing the true root cause, reoccurrence was still within the realm of possibilities. But what could have caused this? Well, edge servers contain software to perform all kinds of operations on the content they deliver. This was the clear common denominator among the three aforementioned features. They all parsed and modified the returned HTML content in some way. Email obfuscation would erase any email addresses in the returned web page if the requester's source IP was deemed suspicious. Server-side excludes is very similar. It can automatically hide content wrapped in a special tag from suspicious source IPs. Automatic HTTP rewrites would simply rewrite any HTTP content embedded on the returned website to HTTPS. Furthermore, these three features all use the new HTML parser mentioned earlier, CFHTML. The engineers, however, found nothing suspicious in the code despite thorough verification. It wasn't until the next few days that the root cause was made clear. Now, Cloudflare had originally been using a parser generated using Ragel, and they were looking to migrate to something simpler and more maintainable. It was in the self-described ancient piece of software that the bug took root. Ragel is a parser language that no one knows how to pronounce that works through defining finite state machines with regular expressions and performing various actions based on the match result. You can think of it like those flowcharts where we start at one state and transfer to different states based on various conditions. For example, here's a machine which matches consecutive numbers and letters. In practice, you can see Ragel code is embedded within C here using the double percent signs. And then it can compile down to C, C++, Java. So why Ragel? It's actually fairly readable and concise after a bit of getting used to, and I'd imagine it's very performant. Or maybe one engineer a long time ago thought it was a fun language and implemented it themselves with minimal communication, and it ended up just working fine. Everyone else was like, well, if they broke, don't fix it, and it was left untouched until now. So the HTML web page consumed by the Ragel parser is represented by a series of data buffers, with each buffer containing a portion of the HTML code. Each time the Ragel parser is invoked to consume a buffer, the user needs to pass in data pointers initialized to the beginning and end of the buffer. Ragel uses P to iterate through the buffer, and PE to tell when the buffer has been fully parsed. In Cloudflare's case, one of the things they wanted to parse were HTML attributes within script tags, such as type or source. Taking a look at the Ragel code, this script consume attribute machine will try to match this regular expression, attribute characters followed by space slash or closing angle bracket. Then we have a few actions. This is an entering action, which will be performed when starting the machine. It simply logs that the script is running. This at symbol is a finishing action, which is performed when the machine completes successfully. Here we call fhold, which is equivalent to p-, and will move the pointer back by one. This is likely because the script tag parse machine it proceeds to jump to needs to consume the space slash or angle bracket characters that the attribute machine would have already matched, as those are also part of the tag. There is also a local error action, which is performed when the attribute fails to match. There is a log here for failure, and then it recurses and tries to parse the next attribute. Going back to the success case, after exiting back to script tag parse, the many parser machines will continue until the end of the buffer is reached. But how do we know if we've reached the end of the buffer? Well, if the data pointer P is equal to the data end pointer PE, then we have surely reached the end of the buffer. So it turns out that something very bad happens if there is an unfinished attribute at the very end of a web page. When this happens, failure to match would occur when the data pointer P is equal to data end pointer PE. The parser then reinvokes itself, now at risk of parsing undefined heap memory. Let's see if the buffer end check saves us. Aw man, the pre-increment causes P to skip over and never be equal to PE. A rookie mistake. But wait. This is a bug in the old parser, which has been in use for years. Has Cloudflare been leaking data all this time? No. So it was actually migration to the new parser that triggered the issue. Going back to the buffer overrun we were talking about before, if there are more buffers to come, the unfinished tag could just be due to the rest of the elements being in the next buffer, so the error action will not be invoked. The error action is only triggered on an unfinished match within the very last buffer, as there is no more data at that point to complete the match. This is why in the example, the unfinished attribute is at the very end of the page, that is, at the very end of the last possible buffer. However, the key here is that historically, when only the old parser was used, it would always receive an extra dummy last buffer that had no content. Why? No particular reason, it just did. This meant that for a website that ended with an unfinished tag, the unfinished tag would be in the second to last buffer, and the error action would not be called. Then, since the last buffer is empty, the parser would also not be invoked again. After the new parser was introduced, this behavior changed, and the empty last buffer was no longer present in the buffer sequence passed to Ragel, causing the unfinished tag to be in the last buffer and making the overrun possible. Perhaps the new parser cleaned up the empty last buffer before passing data to the old one. This also meant that the bug can only occur when a customer enables features which in combination use both old and new parsers. So what can be learned from this failure? Well, here we see a classic example of backwards compatibility. No matter how dumb the behavior of something is, if it's been set in stone for a long time and you change it, something is definitely going to break. However, it's not always so easy to maintain backwards compatibility. Obviously, Microsoft can easily choose to not deprecate the ability for Windows to run 32-bit programs. But see if HTML removing the last buffer, or perhaps more accurately, not adding the extra dummy buffer back for no reason, is something that can easily be overlooked. And it was not just this, but also a bug in the existing code, plus a very specific type of input that in combination caused the data leak. When you consider even larger systems with dozens of interlocking components, each with millions of possible inputs, it's clear that there will inevitably be bugs in all software. So what can be done to minimize impact? Cloudflare mentions fuzzing generated code to search for pointer overruns, as well as building test cases for malformed web pages. There are also various memory management techniques that can reduce impact. This could likely also have been caught by static code analysis. Perhaps another thing worth pointing out are best practices. The coding standards for Ragel are not very clear, but from my limited experimentation, I don't think it is possible for Ragel to naturally overrun the buffer. It's possible to underrun the buffer by spamming fhold, but Ragel's default behavior seems to make overrunning impossible. There's no Ragel command to force iteration of the data pointer, and the way Ragel iterates the data pointer forward naturally is as follows, always explicitly checking if it has reached the data end. This points to Cloudflare potentially going in and modifying the compiled C code rather than the Ragel code itself, something that would obviously not be Ragel best practice. 2 days later, pointer checks to detect memory leaks were rolled out, and 3 days later, the engineers determined it was safe enough to re-enable the three aforementioned features. Cloudflare then worked with the various search engines to purge their caches of affected websites. In terms of overall impact, evidence suggests that it was quite small. There were quite a few conditions that needed to be met for the bug to manifest, and Cloudflare claims that there is no evidence of the bug being leveraged for any attacks. We know that 0.6% of Cloudflare websites ended with unfinished tags, and that the bug occurred more than 18 million times. It is reasonable to say that Cloudflare just got really lucky. In fact, one of the features which could trigger this bug was available as far back as November 2016. Had this exploit fallen into the wrong hands, or occurred more recently now that Cloudflare is so much bigger, there may not have been such a happy ending.